As is our custom, let us recite the Surah Fatiha for those departed ones who are not with us last Muharram, who were with us last Muharram and are not with us today, and also the relatives and the loved ones of all those who grace this assembly. Al-Fatiha. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أبو القاسم محمد ومن المحبين إطرة الطاهرين أما بعد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وفركانه الحميد وقوله الحق بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لن تنالوا البر حتى تنفقوا مما تحبون صلوات Mumin, first off, let us give a loud salutation of salawat for Muhammad, for the passion with which he recited that beautiful poem, which truly gave us the energy, inshallah, to participate in this azah. Salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
And before I begin the subject today, which is about understanding your faculties, we just heard the very good news that inshallah we may be expanding this center, inshallah. Let us pray that the offer is accepted, that we are able to accomplish this very important task of expanding one of the most dynamic centers, the Islamic Education Center of Orange County in the whole of North America. This center has a great reputation. For those of us who travel around the nation, know the reputation this center has. And you know, every center and every community has three kinds of people, like you have bones in the body. You have jaw bones, you have wish bones, and you have back bones. And the jaw bones, like me, keep saying, inshallah, we will have a bigger center. The wish bones will say, we wish we can have this big center. But it is you, the backbone of this community, who will make it into every effort to see that, inshallah, we're able to have an even bigger gathering next Muharram as we have extended this center, inshallah. Let us pray. The ayah that I began with is really a journey. It's a journey where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that never shall you achieve righteousness unless you give something out of that you love. It's a journey. The journey of Karbala was indeed a journey of getting to that level of righteousness by giving what they loved most for a cause that was so important. And indeed, this is our journey too. As we give our time, as we give our resources to ensure that the message of social justice, the core and the essence of Karbala, to stand up for the oppressed, to refuse to bow down to oppressors. And amongst that is one of the biggest oppressors that we have, and that oppressor is sitting right here in this room. And that oppressor is our own nafs. If we allow that nafs to take us in a direction where we should not be going, then we are being oppressed by our own nafs, and we must first free ourselves from that what we call nafs-e-ammara, the animalistic self that we have. It's a journey that we take from Nafsul Ammara with the help of what they call Nafsul Lawama, which is the self-blaming soul, the voice of conscience within me to say what I'm doing, if I'm doing something wrong, is not right, and that it stops me, to take me on that journey towards Nafsul Mutmainna, the self-contented soul, and perhaps even try and emulate those great personalities of Islam who had reached the level of Nafsul Radiya, where they are pleased with whatever state Allah keeps them in Nafsul Mardiya, where Allah is indeed happy with them. This is our journey. In order to go through that journey, we need to understand, in particular, the faculties that we have of the nafs. You know, in the day and age where we live, the normal corporate mantra is, when somebody is trying to explain something to you in great detail, trying to sell you a concept in corporate America, or trying to sell something to you, you say, please, please stop. Don't waste my time. Don't tell me how the watch is made. Just tell me what the time is. Don't go into details. Just tell me. Give me an overview. Tell me what the time is. I don't want to know how the watch was made. Well, if we have that attitude to our own nafs and say that the Sheikh who gives us a promise to say, you will, inshallah, achieve the ultimate in Jannah, you tell the Sheikh, don't tell me the details, just tell me quickly how to get there. Like, don't tell me how the watch was made, does not work. You cannot have reform within yourself unless you've actually understood how that watch is made within you. What is it that makes us tick? And that is the subject today of understanding our faculties. And as we go through this journey, that we began with the process of reform. We said that reform of a society can only come with the reform of the individual. We looked at the power of intentional living, and we said in order to live intentionally, we need to continue to think critically. And we said in order to think critically, we need to make sure that we have sufficient time. We talked about time. Yesterday we talked about the value proposition of a human being as to what the human being is made out of, and the idea of self-esteem and self-worth. And I'd like to continue on that to say that the idea of emotional intelligence, it's the manner as to how we understand our faculties, and inshallah we will continue with living a purposeful life, nurturing the next generation, a concept of a society of believers, and then finally, for a life well lived, we will talk about life is a journey, Islam is a vehicle, inshallah. So we looked at the idea of the value proposition of a human being, that he has been made into the best of molds. Fi ahsani taqwim. The best of molds, and within that mold, as we said, there is the journey of nafs. And we need to understand, man arafa nafsa faqad arafa rabba. The idea is that unless we have understood our nafs, it is not going to be possible to understand our Lord. And therefore, knowledge of the self, inshallah, will lead us to the knowledge of our Maker. And the disposition of the faithful. And this is the simplicity of our faith. In terms of when the Blessed Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and I quote, that whoever is pleased with his good actions and displeased with his bad actions is a faithful. It's critical thinking. Nafs al-lawama will tell me, if my bad action displeases me and if my good actions please me, then indeed I am part of that group of believers. But if I lose that conscience, if I lose the voice of Nafs al-Lawwama, it goes lower and lower and lower. One day it is totally muted and silent, and then it's not going to tell me whether I'm doing something good or something bad, and it'll have no impact upon me. And this is, as I said, the basis of the journey of nafs, and this is a way of ethics. So we're going to talk about akhlaq today. It comes from the plural of the word khuluq, which means disposition. The faculty of the soul where one performs spontaneously, instinctively, without thinking about it. We need to build to that so that we have that. But you know what, when we teach akhlaqiyat in our schools and our Sunday schools, we talk about manners, we talk about etiquette, we talk about, you know, being on the best of our behavior, to be diplomatic in a nice way without compromising your principles. Remember the words of Shahid Ustad Mutahari about the third kind of person who is nice to everybody but he's a hypocrite? That's not the diplomacy we talk about. But diplomacy also means that you use the right words in the right way to the right person to try and make your point. And you become accommodating, you become understanding of everyone else. The idea is empathy. This is what emotional intelligence is about. If you want to succeed in a relationship, if you develop the concept of empathy, then you'll be able to have a much better relationship with your colleagues, with your spouse, with your children, within the family, amongst members of the community. If it's always about me, it's always about my opinion, then there is no peace and aman in the society. But if every time I continue to think about the other person, I put myself in their shoes, before I make a judgment about someone, I tell myself, let me walk a mile in their shoes and find out where does it pinch before I make a judgment. So and so is like this. I've already made a judgment. I don't know what his problems are. I don't know what his issues are. I can only see what's on the surface and I make a judgment. Then I'm not being empathetic. I am being self-centered. And the idea is, akhlaq means that we actually become more empathetic. It's not about table manners. As Junaid al-Baghdadi was admonished by Hazrat Bahlul to say, you don't even know how to eat, you don't even know how to sleep, you don't even know how to talk, because you look at the fineries of things, you look at the rituals of things, you look at the form of things without understanding or going to the essence. You know, it's like when you get a doctor's prescription for whatever ailment, and may Allah keep us all healthy so that we see less and less of doctors. But if he gives you a prescription, reading the prescription is not going to make me well. I have to take the medicine too. To give another example, when it comes to understanding the essence of akhlaqiyat, if we only look at the forms of it as to how we behave in public, that I will do X, Y, Z to appear nice in front of people without understanding the essence, then as Maulana Rum has said, that you take a bottle of perfume, you keep turning that bottle of perfume in your hand, you keep admiring it, and say, it's such a beautiful bottle, and they make beautiful bottles where they put the perfume in, without ever opening that cap of that perfume and imbibing the scent that I have. So, akhlaqiyat is much deeper. Then disposition is, and I'm just at the risk of repeating so that I'm able to complete the argument, we talked about this in the previous lecture to say the disposition is your natural and physical makeup. Some people are extroverts, some people are introverts, some people are easily disturbed, others show greater patience. We have natural traits. Then we form certain habits by a continual repetition of certain actions. Even when we speak, some of us have a specific nuance. You'll find some people saying every third word is you know. They say something and say you know. It's a habitual thing that we have formed. We don't realize it, but it's become our habit. That's become our way of speaking. while you don't have to say, you know, 25 times in one sentence, but it's my habit. And that's why unconsciously we pick this up. And then you also have certain things where you have practice and conscious effort, which if it's continued for long enough, will eventually lead to the formation of the disposition which makes you who you are when you are dealing with people. And I would like to quote, and I quoted very briefly, this book of Jamil Sadat, The Collector of the Felicities, by a scholar, mystic, a moral philosopher, Muhammad Mehdi ibn Abu Dhar Naraki, one of the greatest and one of the most brilliant minds of the 12th Islamic century. And I actually look at his book and his work, and forgive me for taking you on this journey, which may be a journey on a Friday evening, a rather dense journey. But then I know, having lived in Irvine for many years before we moved to Texas, and why I moved to Texas, ask me later. But I know that this center, under the guidance and the leadership of Hujjat al-Islam, Sayyid Mustafa al-Kazwini, has developed an audience that appreciates things like this. It's a mature audience over a period of time that the Sayyid is able to nurture, and therefore I'm taking the liberty of taking this to a notch higher in terms of the presentation, where sometimes these presentations may be a little too dense, and I would be told to say these belong in a university or these belong in a Hausa and not in Hosseinia. Well, the right of this pulpit is that we speak of the best of teachings of the Ahl Bayt alayhimus salam and those teachers who have brought to us the teachings of Aima alayhimus salam. And Sheikh Naraki was one of them who talked about the pains and the pleasures of the body and the soul in his book. So we have two kinds of things. You have Thib, which actually deals with the human body, and you have the Akhlaq, which deals with the human soul. So the disease and pain in terms of the body is a weakness of the body. And the pleasure of the body is well-being. If I'm feeling good, I have exercised, I have eaten well, I am feeling alhamdulillah good, it's a pleasure for me. The pain is that I am not feeling well, my limbs are weak, I have got a problem with one of my organs, that is a pain. When it comes to the soul, we also have the pains of the soul, just like the body has. And that pain is looking at injustice, ignorance, evil habits, and everything else that we see around them that pains our soul. When we see injustice, we are pained. We just heard a beautiful Jummah khutbah today by Sayyid Hadi Kazwini, where he talked about the injustices that go on around the world, and why is it that the voice of conscience is muted? Why is it that people are not speaking up about Yemen, about Syria, about Afghanistan? All these other places, what is happening to the world? One day you have a boy, little boy, who is washed off on the shores of the Mediterranean. The conscience of the world rises for a few days, and then it subsides, people forget. So this is the pain of the soul, and you also have the pleasure of the soul, where you have good moral values, you have generosity, and you have deep faith. And this is where he begins, describing the idea that there is what we call the pains and pleasures of the body, and the pains and the pleasure of the soul. And also, when we talk about the pleasures of the soul, he also goes on to say that there are two divisions. You have philosophy and you have ethics. Philosophy actually means contemplation towards human perfection and trying to seek that spirituality and the qurba of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is very much the divine aspect, as we talked about yesterday, that Karbala had the divine aspect and Karbala also had the human aspect. And then you have, and this by the way is called what we understand in Islamic parlance as speculative wisdom, al-hikmat-e-nazariya. This is the speculative wisdom that we have. And then you have ethics. This is the movement, and this is the journey that I describe. It's a movement from evil habits and traits towards virtuous behaviors, so that our pain is lessened and we get more and more in terms of pleasures. That is the subject of ethics, and that is called al-hikmat-e-amaliya, actually practical wisdom. And when we talk about philosophy, people kind of take it out to say, well, you know, this is not us, you know, talk to us about practical things. You know, where is the beef? Let's just get down to the bottom of it in the busy lives that we lead. Well, it's important. Philosophy is important. But it reminds me of a boatman and a great sage, a philosopher, decided to take a break and goes out with the boatman into the seas. And after half an hour, he couldn't resist himself. You know, the monkey in the mind does not stop thinking. A philosopher is always continuous to think. In fact, Socrates was once sent by his wife to get some fruit from the market. Socrates goes to the market, philosopher, and he meets another philosopher. They talk for 3 hours. He forgets to bring the fruit, comes home. And the lady of the house is asking, where is the fruit? He said, oh, I forgot. He didn't say much. So she started scolding him to say, well, I said, we need fruit. I sent you to do this X, Y, Z. And he said nothing. The wife got very, very upset that day. So there was a bowl of water lying right next to her. And she poured the bowl of water on his head to actually wake him up. And Socrates philosophizes and he says, surely, after thunder, there is always rain. These are philosophers. This is the life of a philosopher. So this philosopher was actually there. And he asked the boatman to say, have you ever studied philosophy? And the boatman says, no, I haven't really. So he said, you know what? You wasted half your life. As they go into the sea becomes more choppy. And the boat was kind of about to sink. And the boatman asked the philosopher, did you learn how to swim? And the philosopher said, no. And the boatman said, the whole of your life is gone. Philosophy is something that we sometimes tend to not delve deep into. But this is something that we need to look at, because this is surely something that we need to understand in the grasp of both philosophy and ethics. And when we develop these faculties, having understood the essence of our living and the akal, the quwwa-e akaliya that we have been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we would be able to understand, because at the time of creation, like an innocent child who is born, the soul is a clean tablet, devoid of all traits, good or bad. And as we progress through, it is our faculties which are going to take us in one direction or another. And that really is the meaning of understanding ourselves, which is called emotional intelligence. And I quoted this from Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, when he said, that Allah has characterized angels with intellect without sexual desire and anger, and animals with anger and desire without reason. He has exalted man and women by bestowing upon him all these qualities. And therefore, as we said before, the man can rise beyond the level of the angels by controlling his other instinct through his akal, because he's been given akal. And he can go lower than that of the animals if he's not able to control those, because the animals don't have the akal, and therefore he can be lower than the animals. And therefore, this is what Sheikh Naraki writes in his book. He talks about the faculties of the soul, and I'll go through this very quickly. And by the way, all the slides will be available At the end of this Ashraf Muharram, on the IECOC website, we will share them, so you'll be able to refer to them if you wanted to. But the angelic power is the one that we share with the angels, and this is Al-Quwa-i Aqaliya. The power of anger, Al-Quwa-i Ghadhabiya, is something that we share with the animals. The power of desire, Al-Quwa-i Shahwiya, is something that we share with the animals. And there is one faculty that he adds, beyond what Mawlana Mutaqiyan Ali ibn Abi Talib al-Islam had said. And he adds this faculty, which is a demonic faculty, it depends how you use it, and that is the power of imagination, the power of creativity, which is in fact linked to Quwwa-i Aqaliya. It is part and parcel of your intellect, but he treats this as a separate faculty in his book. And in order that we can understand this, and images are great, you see there's a rider there, there's a horse, there's a dog, and there's one item that's missing here is another man walking besides this horseman. And if you can imagine and remember this metaphor, it'll be very easy to remember this concept of the four faculties of a human being. You have this traveler who is on horseback. He's accompanied by a dog and a man, a spy. So imagine that the person sitting on the horse, the mounted traveler, is your Quwwa-i Aqaliya, your reason. And the mount, the horse itself, is your power of desire and your power of passion, Quwwa-i Shahawiya. And the dog is your Quwwa-i Ghadhabiya. And the spy who is with you is your imaginative power, your creative power. Now, if you imagine this, that if you allow the person riding the horse to control the dog, to control the spy, and to control the horse, he'll be able to get to his destination safely. If you allow the horse, which is your power of passion and desire, wherever it wants to go, it'll take you astray. It'll take you somewhere. So you have to make sure that you are controlling the horse. So you are controlling your power of passion within you. And when it comes, he has a dog with him. The dog is there to protect him from enemies. Now, if he's able to train and control the dog in such a way that the dog is going to bark when necessary, he's going to drive away the enemy. That's our power of anger. The Quwwa-i Ghadhabiya is such, it is given to us so that we have the strength and the courage to stand up. But you know, if the dog is going to bark at the wrong time, the dog is also going to send away the friends and people who want to be with you. Therefore, you need to control the dog. And similarly, you have the spy who is walking with you, who is giving you intelligence as to what's happening. Are there any bandits on the way? Is there something that's happening out there? The man walking, the spy, is your creativity, your imagination, so that you are able to make the right judgments to avoid any potholes, to avoid anything that's going to be a blockage on your path. Now, if you're able to control all this with your akal, with the power of intellect that you have, then inshallah your journey through life becomes one that has been desired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat. So remember this, when it comes to that journey of life, this simile has helped me along the way trying to think about these four faculties. There is another way of looking at it, that the akhl in the city of nafs is your mayor, the person who actually controls the affairs of the city. The Quwwa-i Ghadhabiya that you have is a police, is your police force to protect you. But as we heard again in the Jummah Khutbah today, that the injustice is such, not far from here, that literally every night an unarmed African American youth is shot by the police. When you have that, your police force doing that, then there is some, because your kuwa e ghasabiya is working overtime, you become harmful to the society. And you know, without a tax collector, they say in America, there are two things which are sure, death and taxes. The IRS will not leave you wherever you go. Well, your kuwa e shahaviya, your power of possession and of desires is your tax collector. If you did not have the desire, you'd not be able to eat, you'd not be able to have the other functions that are required for procreation, for continuation of your progeny, and so on and so forth. But if that particular kuwa starts working overnight, then God save us, you know, from that. And this is something that we need to understand. And the judiciary is your kuwa e wahamia, the power of imagination, that there'll be a level of justice so that you can actually make justice. So who's the boss here? The faculty of reason must be put in control of all the other faculties. If any of the other faculties within you are now not being guided by your akal, then there will be some issues with your disposition. And let us look at the two, the power of anger and the power of passion. The pleasure of the power of anger is becoming victorious, overcoming the enemy, revenge. These are the power, the pleasures of it. And the pain is being overpowered and defeated. And for passion, the pleasure is in food and drink, carnal desires, acquisition. And for pain is the absence and the denial of the above two. Then you look at the power of imagination, the power of intellect. Please stay with me for just a few more minutes. I need to build a case so that we can move on to understand emotional intelligence. That you have the power of imagination and intellect. That the pleasure is in visualization, in creativity, and also in some demonic tendencies that we have. That's kuwa e wahamia. And the pain is insufficiency in creativity. And in intellect, the pleasure is in gaining knowledge, gnosis, and the pain is in ignorance and deprivation of knowledge. So now we'll be determined by the pleasures of the various faculties, and it'll tell us who we are and where is it that now we need to make the adjustment. You know, the purest pleasure that is gained is through the faculty of reason. For a human being, the akal, the use of intellect, is something that gives you the most pleasure. If it's not giving you the most pleasure, you need to reframe and maybe readjust. Because the animalistic faculties of ghazab and shahu are very transitory and they do not have lasting value. Indeed, when you look at the difference between these two, Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib al-Islam has said this so beautifully when he compared the idea of knowledge and wealth. And he says, and I quote, that you have to guard your wealth, but it is knowledge that guards you. The idea of the power of possession is wealth. The power of intellect is gaining knowledge. So knowledge will guard you. In fact, knowledge is something that's within you. Ghazali was actually accosted, the great scholar, was accosted by a robber. And Ghazali said, look, take everything, just don't take this. And you know, when you tell somebody, take everything else, but don't take this, they actually go for it. That's human nature. So he looked at it, it was a little parcel tied in cloth with a lot of, and he opens it, and there were notes written by Ghazali. And Ghazali says, this is my life's work. This is my knowledge that I have. So please take everything else that I have, money, whatever, but don't take this because this is my life's work. Please save it. And the thief, the bandit, the robber, teaches, Ghazali says, the lesson that he taught me, I will never forget. The thief tells him that knowledge that is in a bundle of cloth is really knowledge. If I take it away, And if that knowledge goes away, then are you truly a knowledgeable man? The idea is, knowledge is not to be parked somewhere. Knowledge is something that is going to create wisdom for you. Imam Ali al-Islam said that a man of wealth has many enemies. A man of knowledge has many friends. Knowledge, he said, cannot be stolen, while wealth can be stolen. Time cannot harm knowledge, but wealth rusts in course of time and wears away. This is indeed the concept of understanding your own faculties. And what happens is, and I'll go through this very quickly, that for intellect, it has to be balanced. If the intellect is not balanced, you become simple. It says stupidity is a deficiency of wisdom. And if your kuwai akalya is working overtime, then you become a cunning, a sly person who is more prone to cheating others. Therefore, the akal needs to be in balance. In the same way, your anger, the power of anger needs to be in balance. Cowardice is a deficiency, foolhardiness is the excess of that. And you go on to the power of passion, where being lazy, lethargy is deficient state of the power of passion. And moderation, of course, is chastity. And when you go to rapaciousness, something which is going to take you away is the other extreme of your power of passion, be it carnal desires, be it desires for possession. And finally, the faculty of imagination is that if you are submissive, then there is something lacking. The balance is moderation in justice and tyranny. You become a tyrant if your kuwai, wahamiya, is actually working overtime. So, to conclude, that when your faculties are in balance, when everything is in balance, then the intellect will lead you to wisdom, your imagination in balance will lead you to justice, your anger, the power of anger, will lead you to that level of courage, and the passion in balance will lead you to a level of chastity. And when you ask somebody, what is your pleasure? They will not admit that my pleasure is in eating and in drinking. We try and conceal it. It shows that we are not happy about it. But the pleasure of reasoning is the one that we will try and display, because we are proud of it. It is something that we would like to be known with. So what happens is that you then have the diseases of the power of intellect. And one of the main diseases, and I'll only cover one, there's so many, that if this is not in balance, then the disease of the power of intellect can be either simple ignorance or, even worse, compound ignorance. What is the difference? I'll begin with compound ignorance. Compound ignorance is that you do not know that you do not know. He who knows not and knows not that he knows not cannot be taught. That is compound ignorance. This is a disease of the power of intellect. If you don't know that you don't know, then what are you going to do? Simple ignorance is that he who knows not but knows that he knows, he can be taught. And this is a journey that we need to take. There are others, like perplexity and doubt, shirk, polytheism, that we could cover that some other time. Then you have the diseases of the power of passion. It's always the possession of wanting something, coveting things that are forbidden by religion. The entire instinct of taking, this is how we are made, that the power of possession gives you that instinct of taking. One of the Khulafa of the Banu Abbas wanted to talk to somebody who had actually seen the Blessed Prophet. Now this was hundreds of years later, and yet he had this imagination that he could perhaps meet somebody who had actually seen and spoken to the Blessed Prophet. So he sent out people to find someone, and he could not. He could not find anybody. Finally, an old man of maybe 170 years or more apparently comes and says, well, I saw the Blessed Prophet. So he brings him there with great pomp and ceremony and says, at least I will be able to speak to somebody. I'll have that linkage of somebody who had seen the Blessed Prophet. So he comes and he says, do you remember anything that the Blessed Prophet told you? He said, my memory is very weak. I don't really remember. But I do remember one thing, he said. And I remember him saying that as a person gets older, his tendency of greed becomes more and more and more. He said, that's what I remember from the Blessed Prophet. As you become older, your greed becomes more intense. So he said, at least I learned one thing. And he gives him a lot of gifts, and the man goes back. As he was being taken out in a stretcher, he said, I want to go back. So he's brought back, and the Khalifa is asking him, is a gift that I gave you not enough? Is there something else I can do for you? He said, no, I came to ask, that is this only for this year, or am I going to get it every year? The idea of tamah, you know, the greed that you have, this is the instinct of taking, that is a disease of the power of passion. And then Imam Jafar al-Sadiq al-Islam has said, for the power of passion, that this dunya that you are after all the time is like seawater. Have you tried drinking seawater? The more you drink, the more thirsty you become. This is dunya. And if you try and remember that, that the disease of the power of passion needs to be in balance, so that when we earn the halal risk, and that we are going to make good use of it, and that we are going to benefit society, that is being in balance. But if the power of possession continues to accumulate bigger and bigger bank balances, then we need to think that maybe I now need to readjust and reframe my faculties. The disease of the power of anger, amongst others, is fear in many cases. And you know, one of the most idiosyncratic fears that we have is one of a dead body. If we say that there is a dead body and you're going to spend a whole night with the mayat here in the center reciting Yasin for the departed soul alone, most people would freak out and say, I'm not going to do that. Well, think about it as to how irrational fear can be. When the person was alive, you could tell them off. When the person was alive in front of you, you could hurt them. When the person was not with you, you could backbite. Now he's lying there, can do nothing to you, and you're afraid of him. This is the idea of cultivating those faculties where we truly start thinking logically as to how we can. And yesterday I talked about the lack of self-worth. Having that is also a disease of the power of possession, because I get very subdued. The one that I want to focus as I end is one of the biggest issues of the power of anger, which is self-conceit, ujb. It is indeed a vice of the power of anger, where somebody thinks highly of themselves on account of some advantage. It could be real or it could be imagined. And the Blessed Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you do not commit any sins, I fear that you may fall into something which is worse. He said, ujb, conceit. So, and Imam Ali alayhi salam said, man's conceit is a sign of his lack of intellect, because the power of anger is now taking over his kuway akali. And one of the sages has said that ujb is a tree whose seed is kufr, whose soil is nifaq, hypocrisy, whose water is fatad, actually, you know, creating tension and turbulence, whose branches are jahala, ignorance, and his fruit is lana. This is the idea of ujb. When we don't control this, our faculties, then we go into, like Mullah Sudin was talking about geniuses with his wife. And his wife remarked to say, you know, most geniuses seem to be conceited. And Mullah says, yeah, some of them maybe, I am not. This is the intrinsic thing that we have. So we need to really understand that these faculties, when they are in balance, in total balance, when the horse is being controlled by the mount and the dog and the spy are being correctly controlled, then we can have a smooth journey. This is the meaning of that level of emotional intelligence. Salawat. I will just borrow about 5 minutes for something that we did not complete yesterday. And I'm sure that you're all waiting. When the man comes to the Blessed Prophet and says, show me something where both Allah and people would love me, my wealth would increase, my body would be healthy, my lifetime would last long, and that I would be raised with the Blessed Prophet. We left it at that. And the Blessed Prophet gave 6 traits. He said, we'll need 6 qualities. So as we develop our traits, I promise that I'll cover this today. He said, and I quote, that if you want Allah to love you, be afraid of Him and guard yourself against sin. If you want people to love you, be benevolent to them and decline what they have in their hands. You know, when you go like that, people don't respect you. When you go like that to say, I'm going to give, then suddenly there is respect. This is human nature. And he said, if you want Allah to make your body healthy, pay charity more frequently. If you want Allah to increase your wealth, then give zakah, give alms. If you want Allah to prolong your lifetime, then have regard for your kinship. Sila Raham is something that has been highly, highly recommended. And if you want Allah to raise you with me, then do prolong your prostrations, your sujood, to the one, the dominator. So here we have a solution. If you want all those 6, then there is a way, inshallah, that we can get it. This is a gift that we have from the school of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wassalam. Mu'mineen, when we talk about the idea of reform and the idea of change, tonight we remember a personality in Karbala who actually showed us that change is possible. Change can happen. A human being has that resolution to make that change. It was a day of Ashura. And one man on the other side of the camp, he was with the army of Yazid. And he would hear these cries of Al-Atash, Al-Atash. On the other hand, what he saw was that Yazid army was actually pouring buckets and buckets of water on the hooves of the horses because it was so hot that the horses were becoming restless. This was the heat. And he was listening to the cries of Al-Atash, of thirst from the camp of Imam Hussein. He could control himself no more. And I don't have the words. He was walking fearfully. And some people told him that we've never seen you, oh horror, in this state. You are a brave man. What has happened to you? And he said, by Allah, I find myself between heaven and hell, and I will not prefer anything to heaven, even if I am cut to pieces and burned. I must go to Hussein. I must go to Hussein. And he proceeds to go to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. When they see, he took his brothers and some of other people with him. And when Hazrat Abbas sees people coming, the sword comes out of the sheath, and Imam says, unsheath, put that sword back. I know who is coming. I know who is coming. Hazrat Hur comes to Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Mu'mineen, the conversation that takes place is one of the highest level of spirituality. Hur says, Oh, Abu Abdullah, forgive me. Oh, Abu Abdullah, forgive me that I have been. I was a result of you being in this state. The magnanimity of Imam Hussein al-Islam. It was say, oh, Hur, you have come at a point where you are our guest, but we cannot even offer you some water. But, oh, Hur, you have sought forgiveness. I have forgiven you. My grandfather has forgiven you. Allah will, inshallah, forgive you. And this was the magnanimity of Abu Abdullah towards Hur, Mu'mineen, this change. I only want to imagine the day, that time, in the time of Ashur, when Hazrat Hur goes out to the battlefield and he gives his life. Imam Hussein rushes out to assist Janab Hur. It is said that he cradles his head on his legs, and Imam was cushioning him on his lap. I ask Mu'mineen, I ask you to imagine who was there to cradle Imam Hussein alayhis salam when he fell at Tilla Zainabiyya. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un.